Oh man, I have to tell you about my story of getting my tea and water ready just now.
Everybody get their hellos ready.
Hold on, I'm gonna turn. This is gonna be really weird and a little bit echoey because I need Rose to be able to hear. So I'm turning on some.
Jessica, why don't you do the radio style introduction today?
Oh.
And
hello?
You're on.
Hello, everybody. I hope you're ready for some afternoon Monday tea. We have a little party going on with Sal, aka the Dark Cloak, and Jessica, the other Jessica, Drovi. I'm going to be working on some artwork today, start off the week right.
Yes.
I changed the volume so that it's not through my.
Drovi has a special guest over that she's trying to accommodate so that they can interact with us at the same time. I'm setting up the skateboard art to keep pushing on that. Yeah. It's gonna be a good time.
Rose doesn't want me to have the camera pointed at her. Cause it's pointing at her right now, but I haven't told her. Well, she just noticed. But you know, I've got my little.
It's totally fine. I'm looking at the stream. I'm looking at the Twitch streams for other people's work. I don't actually have the appearing window open.
Okay, here we go. Clicking. Look, there's the rose! There's the rose!
It's not showing up yet.
Rose. It's not showing up yet, I know.
Oh, I see her.
One.
Hi, Rose.
I will. Yeah.
Oh, she totally is your model. Something. See it immediately.
I told you, she's my model.
Yeah.
She is the model. Like, and now I'm making the camera do crazy wonky things, and I'm terribly sorry. Oh my gosh. Okay, wait, this is mine. That's yours, but you're off the thingy. Do we need to scoot over more so you'll be on the thingy? Because I don't think I can.
I'll share my screen and the appearance in just a moment. I'm just finishing some stuff.
Can you hear them okay?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Movement. Movement's here.
Hello. I will put this link one more time in here. Monday. Multi. Please work. Yay!
Who am I listening to? I'm listening to. Okay, you guys might get some echo just because I've got the. I have to have the sound on because I don't have a headset for.
Okay. We'll see how it goes.
For the Rose. Hold on, Rose, say hi.
Hi.
Hi, Rose.
Hey.
Could you hear?
Yep.
Yeah, the echo's actually not that bad. It's actually better than when you have your headphones on. I don't know if that's possible, but there you go. I'm just saving some files here, some client work that I was working on, and then I'll share my screen and you guys get to see what I'm working on. Oh shit! I sent the wrong. Oh crap. Alright. I'll fix it.
Me and Rose are gonna paint together.
Thanks for the heads up.
I love hearing
here with
you
us
guys
today.
Going, oh shit.
I see a bot. I see Positivity Bot in here. Wildebeest. Seahorse.
Cussy.
It's emphases.
It's emphases. Rose and I have been doing these derpy little kind of splashy water everywhere. Nebula-y looking things. After, you know, you're going for like a. Yeah. Can you hear Rose when she talks?
Yeah, she's a little faint, but.
It's a little muffled.
Yeah.
Okay. Well.
Tell her just to, like, shriek. Anytime she talks, she should just be shrieking.
Shrieking.
There you go. Movement. Yen. Hey, Yen. Thanks for dropping by.
Yen.
So it's Jessica and Jessica.co and me. Oh shit, I did that
you
twice.
You do not sound like a small child. You may actually have to talk like kind of loud though, because I think I've got the sound going through the webcam, but I'm not sure.
Okay, there we go. Is she a vulture? Is who a vulture? Rose?
Rose is not a vulture. Rose is my model. Like, 99.999% of the artwork that I do is Rose's bod.
It's true.
And Rose's head.
Okay, I've got this started.
Sometimes her body and her head aren't in the same painting.
Yen says, "Kaka, quack, quack."
Kaka, kaka.
Yen says, "You have a dedicated Rose... model. Nice." Yeah, you guys missed
it. Rose and I used to live together, and she has like the full camera setup and the backdrops and everything. So we would just used to. Yeah, she doesn't have them anymore, but we would just kind of wander over to the photo room and have photo shoots. Rose is the darling model who won't let me near her with tape anymore. Because she's the one that I industrial double stick strength taped seashells to her boobs.
Nice.
Well.
And then took pictures while she was trying to get them off and laughed.
Oh god, I was gonna say, you didn't tear them off afterwards, did you?
She very slowly peeled them off, and I have the best pictures of her making, like, these horrified, in pain, help, help, my nipples are being removed faces. It's great.
So mean.
I know.
I know.
This is why we're friends. This is why you're not allowed near my boobs?
Yes, well, near with tape.
Ah, okay.
Not allowed near with tape. Mine is a super pink one, hers is the super blue one. At least for now. That was Steven the other night with his dragon.
Oh, with his tiny hairy nipples.
Yeah,
that will forever.
Yeah, I was the one who started that conversation too. So, you know. Super dark purple, it's right there. Ah, I got a shiny bingy sound. What is the shiny bingy sound? The shiny bingy sound is Lala. Hi, Lala.
Hey,
I
Lala.
Love you, Lala. Lala gave me shiny cheer bits.
Cheer Aww. Bits.
Oh, Lala gave you guys shiny cheer bits. Lala is cheering a lot.
The Jaja Sal stream.
Jaja Sal.
The Jaja Sal stream.
Just Salja.
Wait, so what did you say? Salica? Last time?
Salica.
Yeah.
Salica?
You're Salica.
Salica. Keep everybody preserved.
Yo, Lala.
It's better.
I'm almost done, you guys, and I'll be able to share my screen. I just gotta save this stuff before I set up. And today I'll be working on the skateboard triptych. Salica Jackson. I don't know about Salica Jackson. Hey, King Lala! King Lala has taken the number one spot on the cheer counter again.
Salabestica.
Salad? No, huh? Salad.
Salad bestica.
Salad bestica. Poor Rose is on a delay because she's just hearing the sound on a delay.
Oh, she's hearing it from the stream.
I'm like, She's like, whatever, I'm having fun. She's over here painting away. We do need more indigo. I'll look for indigo. I've got indigo in here somewhere. Oh my god, did everyone go quiet?
No, I'm here. Well, I mean, yeah, quiet.
I thought I killed the conversation for a minute there.
Yes, thank you. Oh, Lala did the rounds. I see. Thank you, thank you.
Lala's awesome.
All right, here comes the thing.
Okay, I have to edit this.
Well, this is the dried up.
Yeah, I could look at your anatomy, dude. So movement's been doing a lot of gesture work, and he wants to know if he can get some feedback. Yeah, drop some links in the Twitch chat, and I'll pop them up on my screen, and we'll see what we got.
Oh, you said we were doing some critiques today too, right?
Yeah.
Or is that still?
Yeah, it's Demolition Monday, so yes, we will demolition the hell out of whatever you want us to.
Awesome. Meanwhile, me and Rose are just gonna be over here making nebulas and splotchy things. Rose has gotten very good at trusting the blob.
Beware of the blob that keeps besides.
Really?
Yes.
That's what you're going with?
Yes. Love that song. Yes, so for anyone who's tuning in who doesn't know what the heck they're looking at on my screen, this is a triptych three-piece painting that I'm creating for a skateboard company, as they're going to be releasing a series of skateboard decks, essentially the Dark Cloak series of skateboard decks. So that's something that's happening, that's kind of exciting. Yeah, what they're looking for is they're looking for something kind of grindhouse-esque, a little bit 70s, 80s, horror movie, VHS kind of stuff. And that's totally up my alley, and this is the sketch that they chose for me to go with, and that's the one I'm running with. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
No, it doesn't look like a triptych at all. It's like one solid picture.
Yeah. Yeah. But the purple zones are the zones that are for the decks, so that's how that's going to break down.
Yeah, I gotta agree with Luke Maddox. Having your own set of skateboard decks is cool as hell. You'll notice my graceful editing in there, you know. I am the censorship queen.
Are you?
No.
I was like, wait, this is news to me. What? Where's Jessica and what have you done to her?
Well, see, Rose came over and she broke me, so... My brain is broken.
I thought you were going to say Rose came over and I have to censor myself for her. I was like, wait.
Oh my god, no.
I was going to say, that does not sound legit.
No. Rose is strictly for uncensored conversations. Damn it, I wish I had the camera pointing at Rose. With the face she made.
She make a face.
She made a great face.
I have so
she
many questions.
Now.
None of which I will ask
man.
On Twitch.
I think I like this a lot more.
What are you doing, Jessica?
So, this city for a game, the top level of the city is like a statuesque giant head that's been converted into this building. And so that's like what the top of the rim of this huge city is. And originally I thought that the rim of the city was going to look more like... Let's see if I have it up.
I think that looks really cool, that whole... That whole head area statue. Thing looks really awesome.
Okay, so originally
I can't words today.
So originally the wall was gonna be like just an amalgamation of these head parts and building parts, and it was just gonna be like Kowloon, Hong Kong up on the upper levels. But I think it actually looks a lot more symbolic with the buildings being like this. So the structures, I can do a quick drawing here. This is for Sal too.
Yes.
Since he's, you know, artist on our game. So this structure here would be one whole thing on its own.
Wait, multiple tents?
So there's multiples of these tents along the outer rim wall. And this whole structure... floats up above the sector where our character lives. So there's no actual way to get to this top thing unless you have like a gondola type.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Thing to get up there. But then there's like the ground, and then everything below ground is like the sewers and the underbelly of that structure. So like all around the singular structure, there's other structures that make up the entirety of the city, but our character only explores one of these large structures.
That's really cool though.
I'm curious, yeah. Send me a screenshot of that once you kind of have it a little bit more along the way, so I can start thinking about how that's going to work in 3D.
Because
that sounds exciting.
I don't know how to do this upper, because the upper area is not as, there's way less rooms in there. I mean, like, this is like where the top kind of elite live, and so it's not as populated as like the lower levels. But yeah, I was thinking about like the scope and scale of Emmy's you know, the environment around her. And yeah, I want it to feel like a confined space, but also have it be really like modular and cramped, like in the you know, cities in Hong Kong and China and stuff. And
how did I get a brown pen when I picked up black pens? I'm so confused right now. Don't mind me, I'm just randomly talking.
My connection's chugging a little bit. There's a storm here, and I'm downloading the files that you guys are sending so that we can do some critique and review here, so just give me a minute.
Critique and review time.
Yeah. Anybody's curious about the music, it's called Ultraviolence by Time Stalker. Oh, thanks, Movement. Movement says the most precious time on Monday, critique time with Sal. Well, I'm sure Jessica will also give you some feedback.
That can be brutal.
Yeah.
Bad cop, good cop.
I'm like, I don't know which one's the
and neutral
good
cop.
Then,
neutral cop.
Neutral cop. So wait, who's which cop? Now I'm confused.
I guess people just have to guess.
I like that.
Perfect.
I like that. And then every Monday we just change it amongst ourselves, and then people just have to guess which is which.
I like this plan.
I really like that. Movement says brutal feedback is the best feedback.
What, Rest?
I have no idea.
Well, that's because my palette is chaos. Enjoy. I think that is Moonglow is what you're using right now. Rose is getting the fun of trying to use my color palettes, which involve not knowing what color you're using because my palettes are chaos.
But they work for you, so that's okay.
But they work for me. Just not so much when people are over visiting and
trying to figure out what
the hell they're working with, yeah.
So movement in general, I would say your grasp on anatomy is getting a lot better. I'm still seeing that you're getting caught up on isolating parts of the body, and I'm not getting Yeah, I would say maybe you spent... How long did you spend on this one, for example, the one on the right? Because this looks like maybe it's a dancer. Maybe it's a model. Maybe it's a... Yeah, I don't know. But how much time did you spend on this, like, carving this out? Because what I'm trying to assess here is the amount of time spent versus the output that you're getting. This one here on the left, I could see you're doing some leg studies. I don't really know what to give you feedback on this one. Same thing I said before, though, applies about getting understanding of the structure of anatomy a bit more solid. And then building whole figures, because I don't really know what you were trying to do here other than building a study.
Off. Terrible phone.
Seriously. How rude.
Seriously. No one ever calls me who I actually want to talk to.
Right? Fucking. Now, if it's ever one of those Microsoft technical support scam people, please, please, please put them on the stream and let me talk to them. I love messing with those guys.
You're terrible.
So movement says he spent about 2 hours on each. Just the proportions right. I did underlying lines and stuff, and I was trying to construct my first characters. Go for it, Jessica.
I'm just reading his comments too. Construct the first characters. I guess this is kind of the reverse of how I work.
Explain.
So when I tend to do studies for like a character or just even in general, I do a lot of gesture studies, which don't have a huge focus on proportion, because with characters, I find with characters, there's a focus more on what type of movements define your character and like the big characteristics that define your character, like the features. And with anatomy studies, I know that I can tend to get caught up. It just, that's what it becomes, an anatomy study and less of a character study. So I guess I'm just trying to figure out, is this an anatomy study, or is this a character study for a specific character you have in mind? Because I don't know. I mean, it might work differently for movement, but for me, I learn a lot more from the studies that I do revolving around like the character study. If that's my goal, if my goal is to make a character and have it feel like it has a personality and that it feels like a real individual, then that's where a lot of my focus goes.
Movement says, I was trying to make a character study with correct anatomy and proportions. Yeah, I mean, well, for me, the biggest thing is like... Oh, go ahead, Jessica. You
well,
dive in.
I mean, I think there's a time when you need to pick which one you're going to do first. Because, like, you can't... can't quite do them simultaneously. So if you want to do like a character study of the mood and attitude of the character, you should probably, you know, figure out the gesture first, like the pose and what reflects, you know, the mood you're trying to capture, and then you can refine it down into correct anatomy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I think what Vestica was saying is that which one are you working on right now? Are you wanting to focus on the correct anatomy, or are you wanting to focus on the mood of the and the character's characterization first?
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to try to get into as well. The other thing I'm wondering is, what are you using, a tablet to work, or are you working with a mouse? I'm just wondering, because it looks like you did a lot of hatching around the edges, trying to carve out the shapes, and I feel like 2 hours is perhaps a little bit too long just to get to this result, and I feel like it would be much more efficient for you to find a faster way to construct and describe the anatomy, proportions, pose, gesture, etc. Some of what I'm seeing here is reminding me of one of the old bad habits I had, where I used to, like, I would start drawing a character, but I would start, like, drawing an eye, draw a really cool-looking eye, then I'd draw a nose, and then I'd draw the other eye, and then I'd draw the head on top, like, around the eye, but it's like I'd end up with some really goofy proportions by the end of it, because I was kind of making it up as I went along. Now, someone like Kim Jung-ji, he does that all the time, but he's very experienced at constructing. He can kind of see it before he even puts it to paper very clearly. But it takes a lot of practice to get good at doing that. You know, one of my other bad habits is I used to draw arms. I used to like sit there and draw like a muscular arm going, okay, this is going to be a guy throwing a punch or throwing a boomerang or whatever. And I'd draw this arm, and then I'd end up constructing the body around the arm. But what usually ended up happening is the pose itself would get very stiff, very weird looking. Like the action wasn't being supported by the rest of the body because it was just so weird and contrived. And I'm wondering if perhaps pursuing what you're doing here with that approach is going to cause you to have the same frustrations later on. So it's better to nip that in the bud now than to be caught and stuck in that later on. Does that make sense? Let's see. Movement says anatomy, tablet. Okay, you're using a tablet, okay. I can construct things like this faster. I was just trying to make it perfect. Yeah.
Well, I wouldn't hit the perfectioning, refining stage until you've got the entire figure laid out.
Yeah.
Because it's like you're sorting out the bend of just this knee, but you don't have the rest of the body to really say, hey, you know, the weight would shift that way, or you know, the muscle would turn in a certain direction, because all you have is just a torso.
I mean, yeah, I don't really know what's going on here, so like, I get the gesture of it. The gesture of it is like, you know, she's leaning or he's leaning their weight on that foot. That foot's kind of like back here. Like, I get all
that's
that.
That's totally not what I thought.
Really?
Yeah.
What are you seeing?
Well, now that's all I can see, because you did.
Oh, because I did this, yeah. Yeah, and that, see, and then that right there is a really good example. What just happened between Jessica and I is a really good example of why this gets problematic, because what you're describing isn't clear, and if people are just making stuff up, including yourself, like, as you're working on it, that lack of clarity will have an impact on the overall art. I don't know if you guys want to say something further on that particular aspect.
Oh, I saw someone laying down with their arms up over their head, kind of like draped up over their head, because of the where the shoulder
and the
way the back is arched, yeah.
Oh yeah, that does change it completely. Because then now we're looking at, let's see.
Completely different angle, too.
What do I do? The weight of the gesture is very different.
Okay, yeah, take it. Take it, go away. Go away.
Because then this arm.
Keep in mind 99% of the time, and I'm loving the term 99% of the time apparently, but I go for the arms stretched up just because I really like how that looks, you know, like when a woman's got her hands up because she's piling her hair up on top of her head and things like that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, that's such a great pose, so that's where my brain jumps to almost immediately.
Okay, movement says he had my image in mind.
Yeah,
what I described.
The leany thing.
Well, that's good that I was able to capture that, but you know, you're saying that you spent all that time doing it perfect, but it's like, where are the feet? You know what I mean? Where are the arms? What's going on? Like, this part of it, like the upper arm here, feels almost too thick and too big to me compared to the rest of the proportions of the body, and I'm not entirely sure what the intent there was. The pelvic area looks wrong to me as well. There's some adjustments that need to happen because it's like, are they wearing a skirt or what's happening there? Like, how is this actually constructed? Because there's some extra lumps here that I'm not entirely sure what they're describing. Are they describing the fabric or are they describing the body?
Can I have my keyword back? I can't post in my own thing because I'm signed out of Twitch yet again. So.
Oops.
So Yin and Lala, yes, orcas, and now unicorns. You can't see them, but they're there. And can someone give Lala the multi?
Yeah, gladly.
Linky thing.
Not a problem. I got it.
Yeah, that thing.
In your channel. Yes. Okay. There you go, guys.
I moved to type it, and I couldn't even type it because, you know, I'm all logged out.
I'll drop it in Jessica's as well, just in case. And I'll drop it in mine, just in case, because I know some new people just tuned in. Okay, so she's wearing a dress, and it is fabric. Okay. Yeah, I would get out of the habit of pursuing perfection. Perfection, you know, we have this idea in our heads of what perfection is, but we don't really know what perfection looks like. And... yeah, it's kind of like a dog chasing its own tail, really, at that point when you play that game. I would just say focus on constructing characters that are believable in terms of gesture, in terms of performance, and in terms of proportion. Now, it also depends on what kind of style you're going for. Like, if you were telling me this character was like your take on a new character for SpongeBob SquarePants, I wouldn't believe you. Because none of the characters in SpongeBob SquarePants look like this. You know, then I'd be looking for something very, very stylized and crazy, right? Like some weird blobby shape and, you know, that's their head and... then it wouldn't look anything like what you did, you know? So really it depends on what you're designing for. But one of the things about... that I do want to talk about as well, in regards like animation and stuff like that, is even though characters for animation are very exaggerated and they don't look anything like human shapes, the understanding that the people who do animation have of actual human anatomy and how they apply that to even made up characters like this is still very strong, because it's all about conveying certain movements, conveying expression and making it in such a way that your brain interprets it the way it's meant to interpret it. And because we're used to seeing humanoid shapes, you know, two arms, two legs, and then anything beyond that, we're kind of building on what our brain already accepts and understands.
Hey, Sal.
Yeah.
What do you think about the fact that cartoon characters inevitably revert to four fingers instead of five?
What do I think about it?
Yeah, why do you think that happens?
I think it's because it's a good way to simplify hands, because sometimes when you're drawing four fingers plus a thumb, it feels like it gets too crammed. I don't know. I mean, The Simpsons does it. Maybe it's because pinkies are actually useless, and those artists hate pinkies.
I'm using my pinky right now. It is bracing me against the thing.
Well, there you go. If you were a Simpsons character, you wouldn't be able to draw.
Yep. It would be traumatic and awful. And honestly, I wouldn't survive The Simpsons, so... I'd be like freaking Flanders' wife and mysteriously die somewhere or something.
So this is a really good topic. Bestica, what do you think about the four-finger thing? The four-finger, mm-hmm. three-finger thing?
Three-finger, four... Sorry, what?
Oh, the question that came up was, you know in animation how oftentimes they simplify hands to have three fingers and a thumb?
I don't know. I feel neutral about it. I mean, it's a stylistic choice, and I wouldn't be surprised if it had actually, like, a really cool history.
Yeah, and I do use an old toothbrush and white paint, and I also just hand dot them on with white. It's whatever my mood is at the moment. Yin was asking how I do. Oh my god, I didn't tell Rose how to use the toothbrush. Okay, guys, I'm gonna do a toothbrush splatter.
Nice.
I'm so sorry, Rose, in advance. She is gonna murder me now. And Yin, it's all your fault for bringing this up. Because I'm gonna show her this, and she's going to kill me live on Twitch.
Cool. So this could be used as evidence in a murder trial someday. Nice.
Yes, this will be evidence in a murder trial.
Jurors, okay. If you like what you're seeing, please go to thedarkcloak.com.
Okay, so we've got... First off, I have to fix my toothbrush because I haven't used it in forever. A bunch of white acrylic paint. And then you need a really old toothbrush that isn't totally destroyed like my toothbrush is. Okay, this will work. So you get a bunch of water because you need this to be really watery, and you want to use water that's actually clean, not blue like my water is. Oh, well, I turned it white. I'm sorry. Okay, get it nice and gooey and stuff, and then you kind of squeeze a little, make sure you don't have any big globs. And then you put your nail to your brush and you go.
The sound effects are definitely necessary.
I mean, agree. Really, you can't have star action without, you know.
I mean, if you want to be a real artist, you have to learn how to make those sounds.
Yeah. Pachoo, 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 pachoo. Oh, shit. And so you want to avoid that because that's what happens when you have too much water and suddenly you get this really big blob. I'm going to leave that there, though, because I'm gonna fix it. Okay, here you go, Rose. And then your hand looks like this. And, you know, you try to clean it up. So Rose hasn't killed me yet.
Yet.
I'm feeling pretty good here. See, Rose immediately got a giganto blot. It is not all. Ta-da! Now you've made stars. You could leave the blob, and it's just like big space. The final frontier.
Big space, the final frontier?
I don't
negative
know.
Space,
I'm gonna
the final
this.
Frontier.
That is no moon.
So Moomin had a really good question. I'm having style issues. I don't know where I'm going, and I do realize that style is something that comes with time, but it is also a choice you make. The way I look at art movement is you're learning a language. You're learning a whole new language, right? And in language, there's a shit ton of words you can use to describe something. Now, style is when you have a grasp of the language and you choose which words you're using to describe what you're trying to describe. That's what style is. I think putting style before learning the language can sometimes be like putting the carriage before the horse. Jessica, would you guys like to elaborate on that? Because I think that's a really big topic, and I think both of you guys have a lot of experience in that.
Jessica, do you want to go first?
You can go first, Color.
I feel like we just like put her on the spot, and we just witnessed a mild panic right there.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the thing is, a style is something that evolves over time as you learn your voice. You know, what you want to do, art about what you like, what you... Wow, Rose. Okay, Rose made an interesting painting choice with hers. I'm just going to keep over here doing my own
thing. I'm just going to
Anyways. Do you want the pen? Okay, so like, you don't really need to think about style. Style isn't something that you pre-plan when it comes to your own voice. It's something that's just going to evolve naturally over time, like the way you... Rose made a mothership. The way you speak, for example. You know, you learned, you know, like Sal said, you learned how to talk first, but then you're not, that's not, no, don't stand on the table. Oh, that was, okay, you guys don't want to know what Rose
Sounds
just
like
did.
Chaos over there.
It is chaos. But, I mean, just because you know how to speak doesn't mean that you naturally are going to be able to write poetry a certain way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and when you learn how to rhyme words and stuff, that's when you start creating a rhythm and creating poetry and develop your style just by practice. But it's a really natural evolution. I am sorry, I lost my whole train of thought because Rose just climbed over a chair, and the chair's bigger than she is, so it was amazing. Okay. Bestica, maybe you should go. Because, wow.
Because chaos.
Because chaos.
I don't know. I think you explained it pretty well. It's hard to... When you're able... It's just like when teachers teach subjects to students. If you can explain it yourself really well, then it tends to mean that you know the material and you really understand it. Like, if you can explain it to somebody else and they understand it, then more than likely you are also understanding the fundamentals. And I think knowing the fundamentals and being able to, like, describe your ideas, it's just going to give you clarity when you're trying to figure out where to take your artwork and your characters. 'Cause there were a lot of things that when I started drawing and painting, these were like convoluted ideas to me, and I was just trying to make sense of them in my mind. But there's a whole, you know, library of knowledge out there where people have already understood these theories and given them names. So it just allows you to think so much faster. And put into like perspective all these different ideas so that you're not sitting there having to, I don't know, deal with nebulous. Because like things like high key, low key, middle key, and all like color theory, right? Like you've got your complementary, your split complementary, your triads, your tetrads. And, you know, these are concepts that you might... There are some concepts that you might understand, like, on just a natural level. Like, there are some people that have, like, this natural connection with color that I do not have.
Really?
So, yeah, I don't have the best, like, if I were to just sit down and do color, I tend to go for color palettes that I'm really comfortable with.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, if I have to make my own palettes and how I'm gonna like distribute them and figure out all like how the color is affected by the depth in my paintings, then I have to do a little bit of research. But that's what all that information is there for, is once you get through all that information and problem solve your way through things, you'll have a much better understanding of it. So then the next time that you do it, your knowledge base just kind of scales, I guess.
Yeah.
Because I've seen this a number of times with students where they start an artwork,
mm-hmm.
and then they finish it. And then when they're starting their new artwork, they start from scratch all over again.
Right.
Like, I don't know how to describe it other than, like, they're doing, let's say, like, a painting that has a figure in it, and they start from doing a figure study, and they do, like, really intensive figure studies. And they know that stuff now. Like, it should be, you should be doing that study well enough so that you're understanding what's going on, so that when you move on to a new painting, you're not having to do that process all over again. Like, it's just extra work for you if you're, you know, having to spend just repeating the same process every time and not actually learning, like, you know, how flesh moves and how muscles connect and you know, general proportions.
Yeah, describing mass, describing weight. Movement, does that help? Movement said, but especially with faces or muscles definition, you can choose the amount of realism you want, which also cranks up the difficulty in return. Well, yeah, that's why this stuff is hard. If it was easy, everybody would be doing it at the same level.
Yeah.
I mean, even art's a trained skill. It's not just something you can do like breathing. It's actually a trained skill set.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, don't feel bad that you can't magically do it right away. You know, you gotta learn it.
Yeah, a lot of observation, a lot of it's observation and application of what you're observing, even in stuff that you're making up. So, for example, you know, I don't know, this statue here. I'm making this up. I'm not using reference for it, but I already have an idea of what I'm doing. And I already know that my light direction is going to be coming from the moon here. So based on those quote-unquote rules that I've set up in the image, everything that I then do after that's going to be serving or at least loosely adhering to those rules. And the same thing works with color, right? Like if you say the color of this moon is going to be red, well then in that case I'm going to imagine that the sky is also going to have some redness in it, depending on the distance and size and brightness of the moon and how much of an influencer it is. I think of color as if they're having a conversation on the canvas with each other. Like the way colors interact, and whichever color is the loudest color is going to affect the other colors to some extent. There's going to be influence. But you know, that's me kind of making abstractions to kind of keep myself flowing within the goals that I'm setting for the work that I do. And that might change from piece to piece. So, anyway, I forgot where I was going with that.
We were talking about how the rules, like once you've learned something, you can apply it without having to do the studies again.
Oh, right.
You know, once you know how to do addition, you don't have to learn how to do addition every time you need to do a math problem.
Yeah.
Yeah, and I think people underestimate having references with you. Like, ever since I've installed PureRef, which is just like an image viewer thing, I have so many ref boards that I just have, like, on the ready. Because sometimes you're sitting there alone with your painting, and I don't know about you guys, but, like, all of the knowledge that you have is in your head, but sometimes it's hard to access it all at the in that moment.
Mm-hmm.
So I tend to have references on the side so that when I look over at them, I can be like, I don't know, for me it like triggers something in me. Like having to analyze a face that already exists triggers like everything about facial anatomy that I know.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Yeah, or like looking at how color palettes work, that has nothing to do with like the piece that I'm working on. Like it's, you know, a finished artwork that's on my other screen and I'm not looking at my artwork, so I can just focus on that. It like triggers all these things so I can bring it back into my artwork.
Yeah.
And like I it's so funny seeing people hack away at a piece thinking like I can't copy or reference or like get inspiration from anything else. I just need to sit here and make something like so original and like I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if you guys watch my stream a bit, whenever I do these random things, you know, sometimes someone will say, draw this, and I'll be like, okay, well, I have no idea what that looks like, so I go onto Google and, you know, I'll pull up my references, and here, I'll pull up one. I'll often pop my references up onto the screen so that people can see what I'm looking at, because there's one thing to use a reference, and there's another thing to
just copy it.
Yeah.
And
if you're it's kind of a fine line that's really hard to follow. But here, I'm gonna pull up my reference for the Fool. So I did the Fool card, and she was a ballerina. And so I pulled up references of different ballerinas in kind of similar poses. And then I composited their bodies together to make the pose I wanted. So this picture here has the arm of another girl, the face of another girl, the midsection of another girl, and the legs of yet a third or fourth. So that gave me the pose that I wanted, but it also gave me references of like where the fingers go, how the fingers look, how the legs look. But when you look at my actual drawing, which I'll pull up as well. Sorry, I should have had this already sorted out, but I didn't know we were gonna talk references. Low resolution files. I have like hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of paintings. So figuring out where I save things is a little bit tricky. So where did I put it? What did I name this? Did I name this anything?
I don't know.
Sometimes I don't name my paintings, and then I can't remember what word I put with them.
Untitled dash one.
Yeah.
They don't need to know that.
Okay, so I actually gave it a name. Hey, we're doing good. We're doing good. I gave it a name. I found it. Nope, nice. It was the Fool. Okay. Let me move this or not. What am I looking at? Oh. Okay. So when you look at the painting with the reference picture, you can see that obviously it's the same pose, but definitely not the same dress. Her face is different. I didn't go for an Asian woman. I went for a more European woman. Her feet are, well, her legs have the same pose. I went for bare feet, so I you know, sort of feet are different. So you can tell that this was my reference picture. But you also can tell that my painting is a completely different piece from that picture.
Now, to get to the point...
Of course, that picture's also a bunch of pieces.
get to the point where it's like a completely different piece, though, would you say that it's fair to say that your own understanding of anatomy and gesture and everything helps inform the resulting permutation of the references that you put together for it?
Well, yeah, because I... You know, the all these different women that I used to create this composite image were in wildly different poses. And so I had to, like, resize the hands. I had to even warp them a bit to get them to be the right shape and angle for the position she was in. You know, the body for, like, the torso part is more forward-facing than the hips. The hips, actually, like, if you went directly by this reference, her spine is completely twisted around in total comic book hero twisting.
Yeah.
Because her hips are not laying in the same direction as her arms and her chest. But I could adjust it in my picture so that it doesn't read as her back is twisting into some crazy thing. I mean, it's still twisting into something crazy, but not broken spine like it looks like in my my reference compilation. And I didn't need that to be perfect. I just needed to have a rough idea to make sure that I had the composition layout that I wanted. You know, proportions of her heads and her head and her legs and where her arms go out to and that kind of thing.
Yeah. All right, Yen, I have not forgotten about you. Let's talk about yours. So Yen sent this really cool looking concept for a creature. I really like the way it looks. Is there anything specific? Again, I hope you're still there. Is there anything specific that you're looking for feedback on this? Because everything I'm seeing is pretty solid. Like, if this was supposed to be a concept art and kind of like visual development of this creature, like this sea creature, I would say this is pretty fucking solid. Jessica, you guys want to dive in on this one at all?
What?
I like it. It reminds me of. Yeah, the, like, scientific drawings.
Yeah, I like the head variants. I like that you're exploring, hard scale ridges. Kind of like what you find on the, what is that, sturgeon? Like those type of fish? Catfish, fins, quills. It also reminds me of, like, an eel. There's that really great picture of the deep sea eel that looks like a fucking monster. Like, I'm reminded of that movement. So Yen says, how pushing the design. I'm worried that it doesn't have enough interesting details or stuff. Well, it looks to me like you're already taking into consideration the lateral line, because that's where your fins are coming from. So that's cool. I like seeing the air pockets for buoyancy and stuff like that. So I'm imagining that behaving that way. You know, if you're thinking about pushing the design, I would say when you get to the color stage, maybe exploring different coloring patterns might be the way to go. Thinking about where does this one particularly live? Does it live in like the very, very deep sea, like down where lanternfish and stuff like that exists? And at that point, do you want to implement maybe some luminosity? How does it hunt? Start thinking about those things, because thinking about the biology or the narrative or the story will help inform the design and let the design tell the story for itself. I can see this thing being very graceful and mesmerizing to like watch swimming around. Almost like a beta ray meets an eel. So I really love that about it. Yeah, Jessica and Jessica, anything you guys can think of to push this design?
So, it actually makes me think of leafy sea dragons, because it's got the roundness of the body, and then it goes into narrow points, and then a large round section, you know, kind of where each of the fins are. And the thing with those are that they're very awkward, and they can't move very well. So they just kind of very slowly drift around. They're hilarious to watch swimming. Flying fish tend to glide a lot. If you're going for it to be able to fly, I think I would suggest looking into the aerodynamics of birds, or probably maybe insects or hummingbirds, something like that. Actual flying fish, of course, they just leap and kind of hover for a bit. But the problem that I'm going to see with the flight thing is that the midsection, the middle section of fins, is going to read as too heavy for it to be lifted in the air. So you've got like this weight distribution issue that's a little bit wonky. Yeah, you may have to like go the route of dragons, like the Chinese dragons that tend to do a lot of kind of weird swirly things. Because then no one cares if it's logistically sound, you know.
So you're getting into magical territory.
Swirly dragon. Yeah. But just looking at it right now, I can tell you I would struggle with seeing it as an air creature, because it's not, the aerodynamics on it are awkward. The same thing with being a sea creature, you know, the aerodynamics are really awkward, but the sea is like so screwed up to begin with that it's easier to, you know, to suspend your disbelief on its shape. But I wouldn't see it as particularly fast because of the lump in the middle. You know, eels are very long and smooth, but they don't have big honking lumps in the middle. So I guess it just depends on what kind of rules you're going to be going with. And then, of course, there's always exceptions to rules, like bumblebees shouldn't be able to fly. There you go.
And then, and then nature goes, oh yeah, how about this?
Watch this. Yeah.
Yeah,
nature
bumblebees are amazing.
Nature has a way of saying, screw you, let me show you what I can really do.
I'm going to say this out loud just for the sake of the stream for anybody watching the replay, but what Yen was saying is that this is actually a flying fish from the novel Stormlight Archive. So it's swimming in the air instead of water. So that's what Jessica Douglas is elaborating on right now in terms of the world rules that are at play in the design of this creature.
Do some more orcas. Since we're talking about fish in the air that shouldn't be in the air.
Oh, that's gorgeous.
Let's put more orcas flying in space. Orcas in space! You know, people really have a fascination with putting aquatic creatures in the sky.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you paint a whale flying through the sky and people are just gonna flock to it, because it's like, what the hell is that thing doing?
It's a pleasant corruption of what we're expecting.
Yeah, it's enjoyable to look at. Unless it's, you know, sharks or piranhas or giant anglerfish, then it's freaking terrifying. But you know, people really like that particular combination.
Well, you know, I think I think comes from a very common creative exercise, right? Is looking for contradictions and how to bring them to life. So, for example. Even these things, zombies, you know, they're dead. They're supposed to be dead. They're not supposed to be moving around. And seeing that moving around is a contradiction. And seeing it in action is, depending on what it is, it's scary, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like those monsters from The Thing.
Oh, God, I love The Thing. Jessica.
The Thing is awesome.
Jessica the Bestica. Hmm? Any elaborations on Yen's fish, flying fish creature design?
I don't think so. I would just ask lots of questions about it. I mean, I want to know, like, where it lives, its different movements for different situations. Mm-hmm. You know, what's going on, like, more in depth into particular places, like the inside of its mouth, or you know, like the gill region. Yeah, I mean. Well,
and it's flying, so I guess gills aren't really a thing. But I mean, I guess it depends on how high it flies too, right? Because like if it flies too high, then it's still gonna need a way to either be like a whale, where it has to
mudfish.
Like
yeah,
mudfish?
Is it like a flying fish, like just that it stays in the air a lot longer? Like I you know.
Oh yeah.
These are interesting biological questions that can be told through the. Yeah. The illustrations.
Here's what I want to know.
Fish can travel on land and survive out of the water.
What does it eat? Where does it sleep? I'm curious about how
it
would sleep.
Is it a carnivore or herbivore?
Yeah. Does it eat clouds?
Yeah, bestiaries are always my favorite. Like, the stuff from, like, Spiderwick Chronicles and...
I'm super excited for Crystal Fully's Untamed Bestiary.
Me too.
Yeah.
So can't wait for that.
Is that pretty good for you, Yen?
Who's bad cop? Who's good cop? Do we know yet?
I'll say maybe like let's reveal it at the end of the stream. Let's see, well let's do a tally at who thinks who is who, and then we'll reveal
Hi,
it.
Hi, Altair.
That works.
Yeah.
Okay.
Cool. Yen says, thank you all very much. You're very welcome, Yen. And thanks for bringing stuff for us to critique, you guys. Like, I know it's sometimes a little bit intimidating to have stuff critiqued on the stream and shown on screen and all that stuff. So kudos to you guys for stepping up.
And, I mean... That's, you know, this is something actually that I've been trying to express to people in the Zox group, because there's a group called the Zox Idea Factory, which is specifically for artists who are looking to submit their work to the Zox company. And so everything that's posted is posted for feedback.
Mm.
And the catch is that when I go into feedback mode, I don't actually have a particular emotional feeling about anything that I say, because feedback isn't really about emotions and
right.
Trying to be nice and, you know, make sure no one's feelings are hurt, blah, 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 all that crap.
Right.
It's literally about looking at a piece of work and analyzing it in rather cold and logical ways. You know, that's the part where
it's problem
you're
solving.
Not looking at it. Yeah, you're not looking at a piece of art as a piece of art. You're looking at it from a technical point of view.
Yeah.
So oftentimes people get really anxious about getting critiques because they're feeling anxious that it maybe makes them a bad artist if there's a lot of, you know, no praise going on or not a lot of this is fantastic, this is awesome. And it's like, no, your piece could be amazing and wonderful, but it still has blah 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 anatomy issue.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm gonna say, while we're in critique mode, I'm gonna say, okay, here's your issues, blah 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 blah.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, some people do the sandwich method where they go, here's what you're good at, you know, this looks really good, here's what needs to be fixed, but this looks really good too. And I don't do that a lot because I just don't have a lot of time.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it is important to know what you're good at.
It is.
Too. And it's important to know that critique mode is not art appreciation mode.
Mm-hmm.
Art appreciation mode is completely different from critique mode. You know, when I go to an art gallery and I look at the art, I could give a rat's ass if that arm is the most out of proportion thing I have ever seen in my entire life.
Frazetta.
I'm there. Yeah, I'm there to see the emotional context, to see the final presentation. So I turn off my critique brain and I turn on my art appreciation brain, and that's when I start, you know, talking about liking a piece or disliking a piece, because you can dislike something without critiquing it. And those are two entirely different things.
Yeah.
That are a little bit too easy to get mixed up when you're an artist.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, one is specifically, and like, you're being asked to analyze, tell me what needs improving on this, whereas the other one is, look at this cool thing I did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or, I am making this statement. Mm. I want to make you uncomfortable.
Right.
You know, either one can be positive or negative, but once you get your brain to where you can tell the difference between those two, it becomes a lot easier to present your work for critique, because it's not a critique of your statement or the validity of what you want to paint.
Or of you as a person.
Or of you as a person, yeah.
Right. That's actually one of the things that, as we were putting together the anvil and everything, that's one of the things that we talked about, was like, you know, when we're giving critique, it doesn't matter what the person posts. If it's subject matter that we don't entirely agree with, or that we, you know, that's to our standards, you know, putting our stuff aside about it, to be able to give that piece the critique that it, you know, that it needs. Now, if you can't do that, then don't critique it, right? So, for example, if I do a drawing of a pinup girl, like one of my monster pinup girls, right, and somebody starts having a rant about objectification or you know, starts essentially going off topic with the critique, that's not the place for it. You know, it's, yeah, that's a great conversation to have, and like the intent and all of those things, but it's like, if the critique is meant to be about how do I make this a stronger image, I think, yeah. And that's a difficult one, because sometimes the subject matter does cross over into how to make something a stronger image, right? Depending on the statement that you're trying to make.
Well, and I mean, there's a difference between critique and critic.
Yes.
When someone looks at Sal's Monster Girls and says, that's objectifying these girls, you know, this image makes me feel really strong because, you know, it makes me feel like it's invalidating women, or, you know, whatever. That's a personal opinion, mm-hmm. and an emotional reaction that is completely valid for a person to have when mm-hmm. looking at a piece of artwork. It's not a critique.
Right.
It's a visceral reaction and how the painting makes you feel. And that should be said in art galleries. That should be said in comment sections. That should be, you know, that kind of thing is something, a great dialogue to have. You're not discussing if Sal did the piece well enough. You're discussing how do you feel about this artist's painting? You know, what does it make you feel? What does it make you think? This is actually one of the reasons why I tell people that I don't accept critiques on finished pieces or anything posted in like a public gallery, because mm-hmm. I'm not posting it for people to teach me how to do it better.
Right.
I'm posting it because this is my statement. How does it make you feel? What does it make you think? I don't care if you feel, or if you think that
your use of negative space or something.
This piece, the use of negative, you know, this would be really great if you would just, you know, fix the perspective that you have here. It'd be a technically great piece. Yeah, okay, that's nice. What do you actually feel? I don't care what you think technically, you know, and as a teacher at that point, you know, that's not why the art piece is up there.
And I think, again, it goes back to what's the intent, right? Because if you were making a politically charged image that where the message is the main point, more so than the technical merits of the image, then at that point, yeah, I could say, like, you know, I feel like your message is getting lost. Like, you're making this image about, I don't know, gun control or some shit. Then at that point, yeah, like, okay, so what this is telling me is that you're glorifying violence. Is that what you're trying to do? No, I'm trying to talk about gun control. Oh, okay, well, in that case, you know, then you do a critique on how the message is being conveyed and delivered and whether or not it's succeeding on the intent. But again, you do that in a critique space, not a, you know, the gallery, the artist has finished it, it's up. Unless it's meant to, and that's a difficult thing again.
You're getting into the complicated.
Yeah, it is complicated. It's like very muddy.
The muddy, but I mean, saying that a piece is not conveying a message is an opinion as well. Like it's opinion versus education. So yeah. If I go to a gallery and I look at a painting of a toilet seat, and I get told this is supposed to be the representation of our society as today, and I can look at it and I can be like, yeah, no, I'm not getting it. It's just a toilet seat.
Right, right.
That's just my opinion at that point. Now, I'm not going to go in and say, you know, if you took this toilet seat and added this and this and this, it would convey the message better. No,
right.
Because that's a critique.
Right.
I'm going to say, I don't see it. I don't see how the artist is conveying this message.
Yeah.
And that's like the appropriate reaction at that point. You can dislike it, you cannot see it, but it's not your place to then give a lesson on how to do what you think is the right action.
Yeah, that particular part of it still applies the same way. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there's the whole thing about conversation pieces. Which is That's the bumblebee, I guess. In the previous analogy, that's the bumblebee in this particular realm. All of these things, like if a piece is meant to incite conversation or discussion, I don't know. To me, it feels like a lot of times that just basically makes the people discussing it part of the art.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Well, it's like the great bull down on Wall Street. That was meant to inspire and encourage people during the Great Depression and everything. It was meant to say, hey, you know, we're strong, we're united together, our economy is going to be powerful and strong like a bull and all that.
Mm.
But then in modern times, people don't feel that way about Wall Street. So someone put a sculpture of a little girl staring defiantly at that bull.
Yeah.
And it completely changed the tone of the bull.
Right.
Now when you look at those two, it's more like Wall Street is trying to run down this little girl that's defying Wall Street. Mm-hmm. And that opened a whole dialogue about all kinds of things, from does the meaning of the bull change because of this little girl here, and all the way up to do the artists have the right to do that, to change the meaning of the great bull? You know, is that something that's okay? Is that actually an artistic statement? All of that. And that's all really cool conversation to have.
Yeah, and it's got a lot of rabbit holes, because then you can get into the whole Confederate hero statues and all that stuff as well.
Oh yeah.
No, so there's a lot.
Clog these pins, if they get clogged, you just do little circles on your hand.
But yeah, those are great conversations.
Yeah, I'm doodling flowers on my hand.
Yes,
sorry, I was showing Rose how to unclog a gel pen.
freaking gel pens. Yen says, dynamics and relationships in between. Yeah.
Yeah. any dolphins in the sky. I already did orcas. I guess I'll have to paint another one. Oh, wait, say it louder.
Hi, Shannon.
Okay.
Shannon! Shannon in here?
Yep, Shannon's here. Shannon says Rosie
in the house.
With a purple heart. So I just want you guys to know, okay. This is completely off art subject, but it's really great and I have to share it with you guys. So over the past year, 2 years, I've been receiving mysterious packages in the mail of random shit. For example, this cool little wiggly dragon thing that chills on top of my monitor was one of those things. And they'd always come with a note that said, one potato, two potato, and then whatever it was, like dragon, and then it would be signed Zeus. And the thing is, Zeus is my now retired service dog who went viral for bringing me potatoes instead of my medications. Because I was out of my medications and he panicked and brought me a potato when, you know, because he needed to bring me something because I needed medications.
Right, right.
But they weren't there. And, I mean, it worked. I busted up laughing, you know.
Yeah.
But the whole story about Zeus went viral, and so I'm getting these packages that are great, and they're all stuff I like dragons and gemstones and rocks and books on succulents and things like that. And I'm just going, who the hell is this? Because Zeus went viral. He has been shared over 10 million times.
Wow.
There have been newspapers have contacted me and done interviews with me about Zeus. Zeus is more famous than I will ever be for bringing me a potato.
Right.
And I'm just like, twice. Yeah, he did it twice. And it didn't help that at the time we didn't own any potatoes.
Oh,
so
man.
We didn't know where the potatoes were coming from to top that off. And it was just like this huge train wreck. So these packages have been coming and I have been asking forever, and you know, who is doing this? And bit by bit, my friends were suddenly joining in and knowing who it was. And so I knew that there was this group of people involved in this at this point. And they were all being shipped from different parts of the US and everything else. It was just crazy.
Potato-spiracy.
It's potato-spiracy, yes. And so we went to Lagoon yesterday, or, you know, this weekend, Saturday. And when I woke up the next morning, Sunday morning, I was feeling like crap. I didn't want to get out of bed. I didn't want to do anything. And Sean comes in and he's like, Jesse, you can't ask me why, but I need you within the next 3 hours to get up and take a shower and put real clothes on. And I'm sitting here going, but I just want to lay in my pajamas and not shower and not do any of that. And he's like, you can't ask me why, just do it.
Okay.
And I'm like, okay. So I wind my way through this. Meanwhile, everyone's cleaning the house. Like, getting all the garbage picked up, everything's getting, you know, shampooed, the carpets. I'm like, what the hell? So I knew someone was coming over at that point.
Right, right.
And then Sean rushes out to get the stuff.
People cleaning the house and you didn't ask them to? Yeah. That's a dead fire giveaway.
Yeah, and he always does, he cooks whenever people are over. It's what he loves to do.
Mm.
So he's got the stuff for a barbecue and everything. So I'm like, okay, so we're expecting someone. So I don't get on the computer. Instead, I go sit on the couch, you know, and was playing on my phone. And Sean walks in. He's like, are you sure you wouldn't be more comfortable in your studio? And I'm like, but I'm on the couch. I'm chilling. He's like, but you're never on the couch. And, you know, he had this whole thing before he got me to go into my studio.
God.
Because it's isolated from the rest of the house.
Right, right.
You know, and then he like, kind of cracked my door half shut and everything, and I, you know, I knew, obviously, I'm not stupid. I'm like, something's going on.
Yeah.
You know, he's gonna do something. Here's where it got tricky. Our dogs bark at everything.
Okay.
But they weren't barking. And Sean's in the kitchen cooking. And, you know, so I kind of space out at that point. So Sean calls me. He's like, Jess, can you come here for a minute? And I'm thinking, oh, God, he's going to make me, like, chop vegetables or something. You know, I'm, like, super grumpy mode.
Yeah.
So I get up and I walk into, I walk out of my studio, which means I have to do basically a U-turn to get into the dining room. And there's Rose. And I have known Rose since we were, like, little. And I haven't seen her in nearly 2 years because she moved to Virginia. And Rose is standing there, and she has this sign here. This is one potato, two potato, Rose.
it's one of
the Zeus things. And she's holding this stuffed replica of, well, it's supposed to be Zeus, but it looks more like Tucker because of the dark fur. But Zeus had black fur when he was a baby. So it's a replica of Zeus holding a stuffed potato. And I'm not expecting any of this, so I'm like, just, I just lost it. Which is why I posted on my Facebook, Rose, you know?
Oh, okay.
Because this whole thing was all planned. And
right, that's
like
brilliant.
Shannon was in on it.
Nice.
Freaking my husband was in on it. I think my kids were in on it. I'm just like, what the hell, guys? So Rosie was the Zeus bandit. No. Rose's husband was the Zeus bandit.
That's so funny.
She was just part of the great potato spiracy. And she was my awesome present yesterday. And she stayed the night and she's still here. So that's why we're painting on the screen
hanging
out. But
yeah.
Yeah, so it's been awesome.
That's cool.
And I'm super ADHD right now because it's like, Rose is here! I'm supposed to be doing art. Rose is here!
Reunions. Nice. Nice.
Reunions are awesome.
Are. Especially when they're people you like.
Yup.
Not so much when they're people you don't want to see ever again.
Shannon is somehow in on everything. She's like...
Of course she is.
She's like the stealth bomber, but she has bright red hair, so you'd think that she couldn't stealth anywhere, but...
Shannon!
Yeah, Shannon...
I miss you too, Shannon!
Oh, she's a dear Rose, but... Shannon's out down... down in... kind of further southern Utah than I am, where the really big fires are going, and she had to evacuate some family members and...
Oh, crap.
Yeah, it's been bad down there. Shannon herself is not in danger. At least as far as I know.
Good.
Yeah, it's way further. It's like down by Springville, so it's like an hour away from her or something like that. But it was two separate fires that merged together. Neither one were supposed to be big, but then they merged into one big, horrible fire.
Nice.
Yeah, it's been crazy windy out here, too. Yeah, and just life in general has been kind of rough, but...
Yeah.
Yeah,
when are we gonna get Shannon in here with us? That's what I want to know.
That's what I want to know, too. When are we going to get Shannon in here?
Yes, Shannon.
Nay! Nay!
Horsey, horsey, horsey. Whatever sound orcas make. Bloop, bloop, bloop. Bloop, bloop. Oh!
Yay! Oh. Pixel Plague's in the house.
Okay, yeah. Sorry. I'm making whale sounds.
Yep. It's crazy weather here. It's simmered down. It's still raining, but it's really dark, and it's just nonstop outside. And I love it, because this is... just goes really well with my whole atmosphere, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
The rain, and the cyberpunk music, and yeah.
So tell me what you guys think about this. I'm thinking about, for my streams when it's just me, I'm thinking about running one of those, like, 10-hour-long tracks of rain falling... And like storms.
That's what I do.
Instead of music.
Well, I do both.
Well, I'm just getting annoyed with the music thing. So I'm thinking just like nice, mellow, soothing rainfall. It's like... And then I described this to my husband. I'm like, we could call it Come Sleep with Jess. Because, you know, people fall asleep when they're listening to me on my solo streams. And then, and Sean gave me this look like he wanted to strangle me. And I'm like, oh, Come Sleep with Jess. Yeah, okay, never mind. Falling asleep with Jess.
Jessica, mm-hmm. Did you see Marie? She commented
What's
in your
Marie
chat.
What's Marie doing now?
You missed her commenting in your chat.
Wait, what?
Pixel Plague.
Yeah. Hello, Marie.
Hi, Marie. That is your name.
I ditched Jessica's stream. Oh.
You can watch all of us at the same time, Marie.
What the heck? I just tried to put my water bottle cap on my art pen.
I don't think it works that way.
Yeah, I know.
I'm putting some threads on this zombie because I think it being just completely shirtless doesn't work.
Now it's like the Hulk zombie.
Yeah. Yeah, that's working better. Plus it gives it more contrast.
No, I won't watch all of you because I'm petty.
Well, at least she's honest.
Yeah, well. Well, guys, I am gonna bail early on the stream because I have Rose here.
Yeah.
And I've already painted 3 paintings on the stream, so you know.
Wow. 3 paintings and I'm still stuck on this one.
Yeah.
Oh man. It's a big one.
Okay. They're 5x7, so.
Oh yeah. Yeah, this is like 40 inches or some crazy crap.
Yeah, it's not like one of my big honkin' detailed paintings. Rose painted 3 paintings on the stream. So,
nice.
You know. Yeah.
Just keep rubbing it in, Jessica.
6 paintings got painted during the stream. Rose doesn't like the 6th painting, but
It's still 6,
no,
whether you like
I'm
it or not.
I'm just rubbing in. There's still 6 paintings.
Yeah.
So, you know. Just so you know.
Get out of here. Why don't you guys go have some pancakes or something?
Okay. I'm running away. Thanks, guys.
Have a good one, you guys. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Let's see. Oh, hey, Blake. Blake says, the other day I went to grab a bowl from the drinking glass. Blake says, the other day I went to grab a bowl from the drinking glass cabinet, looked in the freezer for the milk. After figuring out my mistake, I successfully made cereal. Then I tried to put the cereal box in the fridge and the milk in the cabinet. Oh, God! That reminds me of a time I was making milkshakes and I went to try to put a little bit of sugar in the blender, and I ended up picking up the flour by mistake. That was fun. So we ended up having to dig out lumps of flour from the shake. It was entertaining.
Sounds like a solemn mistake.
It was totally a solemn mistake. It was funny because I was like, I had a bunch of friends over. We're gonna watch movies and like play board games. Like, oh, make some shakes because I make shakes and I said, does it put like cereal and bananas? Like, I load them up. It was one of those types of things. And yeah, I put flour in the fucking shake.
How could you?
With style, Jessica. With style. Speaking of shakes, I better go get my shake. I'll be right back.
How's everybody doing? Staying alive this Monday? Staying alive. splendidly. Good, Yen. I find if I don't start positive in the beginning of the week, it just sets my bar so low, and it just goes lower and lower as the week goes on.
What?
Huh?
What did I just walk into?
I asked if everybody was doing good on Monday, and Yen was very positive. And I'm like, yeah, that's good. If I start my positivity high on Monday, by Sunday, you know, it's still there.
There's
but
still
if I feel
bar left.
On Monday, oh man, Sunday oh, I'm no. like completely useless.
Yeah, no, I enjoy our Monday afternoon streams.
I wonder if anybody else has got any artwork to show.
Yeah, if anybody's got stuff for critiquing, because it is Demolition Monday, dump it in the chat and we'll have a look at it and tell you what we think. Tear it to shreds.
Shreds, I say.
Shreds. Let's see, Blake says... Oh, Shannon says, a shake sounds so good right now. Yeah, this shake's amazing. It's full of nutrients and vitamins and all the supplementary daily things that we need. And it's a snickerdoodle shake. It tastes literally like a snickerdoodle cookie. It's so good.
That's evil.
It just came out of the freezer and it's just... Ugh.
What did I just say? I said that's evil. Stop talking. No.
Well, maybe I'm the bad cop.
Makes sense. Yeah. Critique. Eek. Something to annihilate.
I think I'm gonna move on to a new layer now. I think this layer's good for the next pass. Oh, wait, I need to put shadows in here. And at some point, once I'm done with color and everything, I'm going to be putting in halftone effects and all sorts of craziness on this. So, this is going to be interesting. For anybody who's curious about the music, I'm playing this really awesome playlist you can find on YouTube. It's called, well, there's like a few of them actually, but it's called It Came from the 80s, and it's all retrowave, darkwave, horror synthesizer music. Some of it is remixes from themes from movies like Nightmare on Elm Street and stuff like that. It's good shit. Let's see. Blake says, oh, probably my most embarrassing moment of my whole life. My car was low on oil as well as radiator fluid in the Arizona 120 degrees summer. Oh, geez, delirium was setting in. I poured nearly a whole quart of oil into the radiator before I realized what horrors I was performing. Oh, geez.
God.
So was your car wrecked after that, or were you able to, like, I mean, what did you have to do? I'm assuming you have to take the radiator off and flush it out and all that stuff, but damn.
That's where you just, like, give up.
Yeah. I'm just gonna ride a bike. Fuck this. Oh, but in that weather. Oh, no. Riding a bike
in
that
weather.
Oh, man.
When I was in Seattle for PAX Dev,
yeah,
it was hilarious because I was talking to a bunch of Seattle natives, and they were complaining that Seattle's trying to be like San Francisco or is turning more into San Francisco.
Okay.
And in San Francisco and like a couple other cities, bicycles are becoming a big thing.
Yeah.
And they were like, yeah, we're trying to implement bicycles because like if you go to Seattle, they're like trying to implement like those rentable.
Oh yeah, we've got those here now too.
Yeah, like rent bikes and mm-hmm. like special bike paths, and like they're trying to move towards a more bike-friendly city. And everybody I talked to was like, yeah, they're trying, but it's failing. Nobody wants to use it. And it was true. While I was there, like, I barely saw anybody riding a bike in Seattle.
Huh.
and it was kind of sad.
Yeah.
Yeah.
One of the things I've seen people saying about the ones here is that it's like it's motivating them to bike ride, but instead what they're doing is they're digging their bikes out of their garages and riding their own bikes. Which is, I guess it's kind of good, but it sucks for the people doing the, you know, the rent-a-bike business stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It's interesting, though. Here it's called Lime Bike, I think? It's like a,
oh, yeah, we have Lime Bike where I'm at.
Yeah. I think it's really interesting. I want to give it a try, but, you know, it's one of those... I don't know, it's weird. It's
funny, there's, like, some crotchety people in our neighborhood who complain on Nextdoor, like... I hate all these Lime Bikes. They make our neighborhood look ugly.
Yep. Yep. Same. See, Blake says, it wasn't a big deal, just a radiator flush a couple of times. Oh, that's good. But my heart fell out of my ass. I was so shocked at what I was doing. At least he didn't put gasoline in there. And of course, it was right in front of my father-in-law's house, right after I had graduated and was jobless and didn't have an apartment yet. I bet he thought I was the biggest moron in the world and I was married to his firstborn daughter. That's like some sitcom shit. By the way, anybody who's tuned in, make sure you guys check out Art of Blake's channel. He does some really amazing black and white artwork, a lot of Diablo-themed stuff, which, as you guys know, I love Diablo. And yeah, go check him out. Good shit. Blake is streaming pretty often, so. Always have somebody to watch.
Mm-hmm. Bad.
Blake says, "Oh, thanks, Sal. I'm not as dumb as I sound, I promise." You're lucky Steve's not around, because you know he'd just be jumping all over you right now. Using the opportunity to knock you down a few pegs with Steve.
Thank you.
Venting his bad experience at what the hell convention was that he was at? Did you hear about that, Jessica?
No.
The Art Holes chat? Oh, Steve was at this... Oh, he posted about it, actually. Let me go look at it. So, apparently this convention was put on by the same people who do C2E2 and all that stuff. The Keystone Comic Con in Philadelphia. And I haven't read his full post because he got into the whole thing, but let's see. I'll have to read it later. It's a pretty big post. But yeah, his first 2 days were really, really horrible. I think it was Keystone. That's when he was posting about in the chat, isn't it, Blake? See this weekend. Yeah, Keystone Comic Con in Philadelphia. To call it a disaster would be an understatement. In the 4 years of doing conventions, I've never seen anything like it. I mean, that's when we were making those DashCon jokes about the ball pit.
Oh.
Fucking DashCon.
Was it a for-profit convention or a...
Yeah. Yeah, he showed us pictures, and it was a fucking ghost town.
That really sucks. I just have a problem with conventions that are... It's sort of like you pay a lot of money, and then you go to these conventions, and you're like, where did my money go?
Yeah.
Like... It didn't go towards like really great service. It didn't go towards, you know, decked out booths. It didn't go towards, and it's like
celebrity
where did it...
guests or yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. So Blake says, Blake says it actually ended better than it started. Not in sales, but he ended up getting a free table at New York City Comic Con. Was that as a result then of him complaining about the way things went at this convention, or I haven't read it yet, so if you get me up to speed, that's cool.
I'm gonna do that graveyard area.
So I have about 2 weeks to finish this.
The thing you're working on now?
Yeah. Yep, I have 2 weeks to finish this. Probably one of the biggest pieces I've done this year. So Blake says that Steve complained in a positive way. He talked to the staff there, and instead of bitching and screaming like his neighbors did, he discussed with staff the problems and such. So he was led into New York City Comic Con after being rejected earlier this year, and they're comping his booth. Wow, that's fantastic.
See, that's how, you know, should be done. No, I should be
done. Yeah, that's great. That is a happy ending. Wow. Blake, this is, I don't know if you saw me working on it earlier in the last week. This is for a series of skateboard decks. A company has hired me to essentially do a line of the Dark Cloak skateboard decks. And, it's three pieces that come together to form a scene. And the purple zones here are roughly where the skateboards are going to be. Or, like, how the piece is going to apply to each skateboard. Okay, yeah, you did hear about it. All right, cool. Yeah, so it's all coming along. It's just, it's huge. I mean, this is like, it's almost 10,000 pixels canvas on this. And the idea is to have it all available for October. So it sounds like what they want to do is they want to give me a stack of them for me to sell at Crypticon as well, which is great, because then it means I don't have to spend as much time creating stuff for Crypticon. So it's going to be an interesting couple of months here, because I've got Crypticon and LuxCon in October, and then potentially a movie that I'm going to be working on in November, December, January. For anybody watching, one of the things that's going on, I've kind of been bringing this up on almost every stream because I want to pick people's brains and see what people think about stuff. One of the things going on is I'm working with a special effects house on doing a panel at Crypticon that's all about concept art to production of practical effects. So, you know, makeup, prosthetics, full body, body suits, all that stuff. And one of the things that we're doing is we're tackling, talking about the pipeline, how artists can better work with the fabrication people for creating effects. Because it sounds like oftentimes a lot of concept artists, you know, they'll create these cool looking monsters, but there's not a lot of thought that goes into, like, is it going to be a suit? Is how the performer's going to be wearing it? You know, all of those types of things. And that slows production down. So, or, you know, if the concept art, or sorry, if the fabrication department has to talk to the concept artist to try to figure out what they meant or what they were describing in their work, even stuff like material, for example, that eats up time and resource on the production, and that's no good. It devalues the pipeline. You guys have any questions or any thoughts on that stuff? Things that you haven't thought about when it comes to that kind of thing? Yeah, drop them in the comments and I'll work them into the panel if I think it works with what we're going to be talking about. I'll be at CryptoCon Minneapolis. Yeah, I've been boothing there for, I think this will be my 12th one. So it's pretty much my main convention every year that I booth at. Occasionally I'll do MarsCon or FallCon or the Minneapolis Comic-Con, but not very regularly. Minnesota crowd is interesting. Yeah, there's CryptoCon Kansas City. That one's run by Chaz DeMoss. There's CryptoCon Seattle. That's the one I hear a lot of good things about that one. Chaz has been trying to get me out at CryptoCon Kansas City, but I'm not sure yet still. There's a whole lot of stuff there, but we'll see. Let's see. Like says he used to do decks, but not professionally, but for fun. Cool, man. And yeah, there's a lot going on. Yeah, I think you should consider the Minneapolis one. I think you would probably do well with your work, the black and white stuff. I was actually one of the first artists that they had at CryptoCon. And at this CryptoCon, I don't know about the other CryptoCons, but I was definitely one of the first here at this one. And yeah, it's been interesting. So now I'm stepping it up with panels and all that stuff for my presence there. Yeah. I don't know that I ever want to do conventions like time or whatever. I don't think so.
No.
Yeah, I don't think so. It's a lot, man. I know people who that's all they do, full time on the road. I mean, Chelsea's kind of in that realm, isn't she?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a lot. How many conventions do you do a year, Jessica, roughly?
Maybe 2 or 3.
Oh, okay, so kind of similar to me then.
Yeah. I don't know what to do. Yeah, not that many now with the studio.
Right.
So.
When the game gets launched, do you think you guys are going to up your convention attendance just to promote the game, or
maybe
not talking about that yet?
Yeah, I think we will, but we have to have a demo. Really sucks not having one.
Yeah. Yep. This guy's starting to come together. Blake says, if I could do one show per month that made profit, I'd be super happy. I hear that.
It's just so much work.
It is.
So much work.
My thing
is, especially if you want to be making money at it. Oh, God,
yeah.
So much work.
Yeah, big hustle. Well, like, one of the people that I know, Justin Orr, he does conventions full time, and he does like 60 shows a year, which sounds insane to me. It works for him, but he tells me he doesn't have a lot of time to do art. So he'll do sketches and planning while he's on the road, and then once he's got like a couple of months of downtime between conventions for the ones he does, he will then produce a bunch of art so that he brings a new round of art with him for the next tour of conventions. And yeah, that sounds too much to make for me. I need to be able to make art more often than that.
I hear ya.
Yeah. This zombie guy. I think he's starting to flesh out, so to speak. Zombie punch.
Okay.
Blake says, yep, that's the goal, but I'd way rather do conventions than sit in this office making graphics for plumbing vans. I hear that, dude. I hear that. Yeah, every time I think about my old job and everything, the first thing that always comes to mind is that I'd rather have a bad day doing what I'm doing now than a good day at my old job. And that hasn't changed in the 4 years I've been doing this full-time freelance thing. So I hope you get that, man. I hope that you get that for yourself, because it's good. It's a roller coaster, but I wouldn't trade it in. I'm very, very, very pleased with having done that, having left the gig. Seeing the opportunity when it came up, the timing, everything, and just going for it.
You know,
as
much as I love sprawling city,
yeah,
the more and more I think about this, the more and more I think.
You're talking about for the game?
Yeah.
Hmm.
There's something very. I'll just draw it.
Oh, just catching up on reading about what Shannon was saying about the fires.
Mm-hmm.
86,739 acres. Holy crap. A friend of mine was traveling up through the Rockies at the beginning of August. And he took lots of pictures, but one of the pictures that he took a series of pictures by this huge lake. I can't remember what lake it was, but there's this huge fucking mountain out there. And this lake is about 5 miles by 4 miles in size. And he showed pictures of the fires creeping over the horizon by this mountain. And then he's like, you know, then we went and had dinner. And about 3-4 hours later, they started evacuating everybody from the area. And we're supposed to go up to a cabin in that range. And as we were driving up, there was just car after car after car coming our way. And we ended up getting turned around. But he said when they left the restaurant about 3 or 4 hours later, they went back to that lake area and took some more pictures, and the mountain was gone. Gone. The fire was like pretty much at the edge of the beach. You could see some of the fire trucks that were abandoned there because they couldn't get them out on time. And the fire was already creeping around the lake. And the mountain was just like, you just couldn't see it. The mountain was just completely consumed by the fire. Really crazy stuff. I've asked him to do a Dropbox and share all that stuff with me because it's pretty amazing. You can just reference and whatnot. But yeah, really interesting and crazy stuff. That's what it was. He did a road trip up to Yellowstone.
I really want to see more national parks.
Me too. I haven't traveled much. Travel more. Stage on this, it's gonna be probably a little bit of a nightmare then too. I think I found my groove with it, found my rhythm and pace with it, so it's just a matter of plugging away at it. Zombies complete without a worm coming out of his eyeball.
Of course. Are you ready for Inktober?
No. No. I'm slowly gearing up for it, but I don't know if I'm ready. Let's see. I was going to do my own list of it as well, but yeah. Let's see. I might just end up doing what I did last year when I combined as many prompts as I could and just did them on cardboard. That was fun. Plus, I sold a bunch of them, so that was good. I sold a bunch of them at Crypticon, and sold a bunch of them just online. Knew about them. Says thank you. I think it will. Stuff's looking better and better every day. Good, man. Good. It's like render, render, render. Get stuck in that like rendering monotony, Jessica.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I feel like that's what's been happening to me this whole freaking session.
What's this one you're working on? I said, what's this one you're working on right now?
So this is me trying to figure out how I want the structure to look with the the top of the building there.
Is this for the game?
Yeah, I'm thinking. Okay, so here's what I'm thinking. I want it to be like standalone, far away. It should be like let's do this. Oops. Come on. What are you doing to me?
Leave that area alone for a while and start working on some of this other background stuff. Thank you. familiar, but take a shot. I may have worked on that zombie a little too long, but I feel like it was worth it, because now he's got more purpose than he did before. Start working lighting effects, it's gonna be another interesting round. Once the underpainting is done, then it's a matter of bringing in the juice. Yeah. Bright colors and everything that's gonna make it really pop and finished. Alright, got this zombie because he's looking pretty neglected at the moment. What's up? What's up, Vestica?
I'm trying to figure out if I want the structure to be standalone with the rest of the city kind of destroyed around it. So here's my thing. The city is really sprawling, right?
Mm-hmm.
But that was, I mean, and now we're kind of like at the end of the rope for this AI entity.
Yeah.
Like Idna's at the end of her line here, and a lot of her focus is in a small region of the city. So I'm wondering if instead of having the city be so huge and sprawling that it is still sprawling.
Yeah.
But that there's like a standing outpost, like the main, sort of like the entry
point of the city almost.
Okay.
That Idna cares for the most in its last kind of however many years it has left.
Yeah.
Because my thing is, it can still have arms, you know, it can still have like its tendrils in the rest of the city, but it's a lot more like, I mean, a lot of the stuff is going to be ruins or kind of melded together. Whereas, like, the singular outpost is, like, the last kind of standing monument of Idna's work. And this is where Emmy lives somewhere in here.
Got it. That's, like, where is it where Idna's the most comfortable, or is it more of, like, a power limitation at this point?
Both. It's both a power limitation, but this is also like the main hub of Idna. Like this structure here, most of the elite and where like the administration buildings is in this head area. And then down below would have been like the residential zone for people that lived in here, and then the mid elite.
Yeah.
Middle class. And then wherever the ground level is, might be here or something. Underneath there, that's where all like the sewers, labs, underbelly, is. And it's also what's producing all the, I did this wrong, but like, yeah, there's tons of vents and stuff, venting out stuff from the underbelly. So this structure is constantly spewing out gas, clouds, smog. So there's just kind of like this air of, I'm thinking of that scene from like Blade Runner, where he's in like the nuclear zone city.
Oh, the
and everything
wait, the new one?
Is like, huh?
In the new one?
Yeah, in the new one. Where everything is just like a hazy orange and you can't see past like 100 feet in front of you.
Yeah.
And that's what I kind of imagine the air would be around, like the immediate area around this building.
Got it. Dust Bowl.
Yeah. Because I want it, like, the thing is, the building that Emmy lives in, it's like, it's about the height of, like, the Burj, what's the name of that building? Burj Khalifa?
I don't know which building you're talking about. The one in Dubai?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Burj Khalifa. So the Burj Khalifa is like 2,717 feet high.
Okay.
So this structure might be like maybe 2,000, so like the Shanghai Tower height. But it's one singular structure-esque thing amongst like all this other sprawling stuff that's hidden underneath the smog. Because, I don't know, I like that better than the city being relatively the same upkeep and it being, like, miles and miles of, like, Hong Kong city structures.
Yeah.
I mean, I want to see the, like, the remnants of the degradation over the years. And if this really is, like, the last, you know, end of its life kind of thing, yeah.
Got it.
I'm still trying to figure out what shape, though, I'd like for this,
Well, think of what it was when it was booming. What was it when it was booming? Was it?
I mean, it was like a lighthouse marker. Like, this was like the entry point thing that you had to see from afar. So you would see this floating head structure, and then I kept thinking I want to turn this into like a, you know, like continuing that hooded dress matriarchal, you know.
Yeah.
That goes down like a wall around the structure, but I don't know, I gotta think about it a bit more.
Yeah. A lot of what you're saying, and I think we talked about this before, is making me think of AI. The mm-hmm. feel of some of the visuals in that movie. Yeah. Especially when they're traveling to the city.
Because I wanted to feel like the city was created with that in mind, right? Like, so if it's just like the structure, and then it's, you know, if I stick a Hong Kong building there with all like its modularity going on, I don't feel like that. I don't feel like that really embodies what Idna's iconography was for them.
Right.
Because it's supposed to be like, you know, the matriarch, the mother, the protector, the wall around them, the, you know, their caretaker. So mm-hmm. I feel like it needs
that impact. Jessica's relapsing to her club kid days.
I love that, though. If we were, like, to get a certain distance away from the structure, that we would break through that smog, and you could...
Mm.
You could, like, see everything around, like, what's outside of the city and the walls, and you just see, like, smog and smoke, and you see the structure kind of towering over it.
Yeah.
Work to be done.
Seriously. You ever have that going on where like somebody says, oh wow, that's so cool what you're working on, oh that's great, you're working on that thing, or you know, that whole thing, but you can't really be with that feeling yet.
Mm-hmm.
because it's like it's either not done or you're not quite at the point where you're like visualizing it yet, so it's like you're really just more wrapped up in the work of it.
Yeah, that's how I'm feeling.
It's a weird place. It's a weird place to be. It's kind of funny, like, people, you know, have asked me about the Guillermo del Toro thing, for example. And, like, you don't sound very excited about it. I'm like, well, we haven't heard anything yet. I'll be excited when I can see it in my hands. Have you heard anything, by the way? Jessica?
Hmm.
Have you heard anything about the book yet? Vestica, can you hear me? I can't hear you. Uh-oh.
Sal?
Hello? Can you hear me now?
Okay. Yeah, I couldn't hear you before. I don't know.
Blake said she's gone. Wasted. That's in the wind. Oh, I was asking if you'd heard anything about the Guillermo del Toro book yet.
Nope.
Damn.
Nope.
See, that's why I can't be excited about it.
I know. I showed Andrew the piece that I worked on while we were at Psychanime, and he's like, "Dang, we couldn't. You know, I couldn't bring that one with me to the convention. It was so sad."
Yeah, exactly. I was hoping that the pieces that I did, I'd be able to bring to Crypticon, but it's not gonna happen. From the look of things.
I really can't show it. Like, come on. I want to show it. Like,
yeah, they haven't said anything. I mean, I know Guillermo's super busy, but damn, man. Come on now. Come on now.
Like, it would have even been fine if we could have shown it, like, in a low res-ish version. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I think they were worried about us showing it full res and whatever, but I'm like, I could just make it, you know, like, 5x5, it's not like I can't.
I guess yeah. Their angle is that if you show it, it devalues the release when it comes out, I guess. Something like that, but the whole exclusivity thing, I think, you know, is part of the sell. But it's like, well, if you guys haven't even printed the book yet, what are we supposed to do? What if you guys never release the book? Then what?
Nope, I feel the same way.
Yeah, it's frustrating and sad. I mean, I'm happy Guillermo won awards, the Oscars and stuff. I just wish they would have gotten the chance to review the artwork sooner. Or maybe he's reviewing it now, because he's been posting on Instagram quite a bit lately, so. Or not Instagram, the other one, Twitter. Anybody wondering what we're talking about, or when we're talking about a book that isn't out yet.
Nice.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to do some things here really quick.
So I watched the that He-Man documentary on Netflix recently. It's great. It's really great. It's also weird because Straczynski's been a reoccurring theme. Almost every day for the last couple of weeks. Joseph Michael Straczynski, for anybody who doesn't know, JMS. He's done writing for cartoons, for TV shows. I've been watching Babylon 5, and of course he wrote and directed a bunch of those episodes. He came up in He-Man as having written a bunch of episodes in He-Man and a bunch of the lore from He-Man. Yeah. He's been involved in Ghostbusters, another thing, the cartoon. It's my favorite thing to throw on while I'm doing the dishes. I'll throw Ghostbusters on. And, yeah, it's just kind of crazy how much stuff he was involved in, or still is involved in. Yeah. It's weird. It's weird when you start seeing stuff like that, like people who show up reoccurring in various things that you're watching or things that you like or whatever. In ways that aren't, you know, obvious, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, then there are sometimes somebody shows up in my movie and show and I'm just like, well, that's been ruined for me.
Oh yeah, like who?
Nick Cage is a pretty big
Nick
one.
Nick Cage! Yeah. Makes sense.
I don't know. Like, there are just so many movies that have him in it that don't... For some reason or another, I just totally missed that he was the star in it or, you know, a supporting actor in it.
Yeah.
And it just really... Just his face. I can't.
So, done. Oh, Nicolas Cage is in this. Watch it. I do want to watch that movie, though. What's it called? Blake, you know what I'm talking about. With the really colorful trailer. Maddie? I think it's called Maddie. That movie just looks insane.
Mandy.
Mandy. Have you seen that trailer?
I have not.
Oh, it's insane. It just looks awesome, but it looks insane. It looks very retro. It's very colorful. And the movie looks just crazy. Absolutely crazy. There's a little bit of folk horror. There's a little bit of, retro 80s horror. Oh really? Okay, I'm gonna post the trailer in the Twitch chat, and then let me go get it. I'll watch the trailer with you guys. How about that? Got the trailer. I'll pop it up on my screen and I'll link it in the chat for you guys too. Let me pause my music. Oh, you know what we could do, Jessica?
Hmm?
We could actually synchronize videos in the what's it? This thing. Up here in.
Oh yeah, you're right.
Let me do that. I'll synchronize it and share it on the screen. There we go. Cause that would be cool. I will warn you, it does play the video at full volume. FYI, just so you're aware and ready. Alright, let me know when you're ready and I'll hit play. And for you people in the chat, there's a link to the trailer. It's really good. It's bonkers. Oh, unmute your mic so we can talk over it too, if you need to.
Okay, so if I hit that link, Sal, it just automatically plays.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it does.
Okay.
That's all right, fine.
Well, then I'm ready.
We're watching it. It's fine. Look at these visuals.
Oh, whoa.
Playing in low res for me because I think I have my YouTube settings set to low res because streaming, but that's okay.
You're a special one, Mandy. I too am a special one. Let us be so very special together.
What are you gonna do with that now?
I'm going hunting.
So what you hunting?
It's crazy evil!
I mean, there's dudes in spiky suits riding motorcycles, like what the fuck?
I'll show you love.
Oh man, they robbed you. The cosmic darkness.
It glowed from within, strange and eternal.
Right? Jackie Earl Haley and... yeah, man. Looks absolutely fucking crazy, and I want to see it. It's like the first time I've been excited about watching a Nicolas Cage movie. Very excited. He says, oh, hell yeah. Yeah, fucking. Blake says, babe, we're going to the movies. Yeah, I don't even know if it's in theaters. A friend of mine said he's got it already. But I don't know if he just did one of those rental things or what. Yeah, I don't want to read anything about it or reviews or anything. It seems like the kind of movie that'll probably be better just going in not knowing what the hell you're getting into. Another movie I watched recently. Let's see, Blake says my wife actually really loves this stuff. Oh, okay. Yeah, another movie that I watched recently that was pretty cool. I had a surprisingly good time with was a movie called Kin, K-I-N. Yeah, really fun film. I don't know if fun's the right word to use. It's good film. I really enjoyed it. It's very much in the vein of a sci-fi short story or like a comic book one-shot. And it's about a kid in Detroit who he lives in like a pretty poor area and everything, and he's a scrapper. And he ends up finding this futuristic gun. Then shit starts happening around it. And yeah, it's very much a quiet, smaller scale sci-fi story. It reminded me of Upgrade. Oh, yeah, Jay Blake just mentioned Upgrade. Yeah, so if you enjoyed Upgrade, you will more than likely enjoy Kin. It has that same small scale sci-fi, a little bit of cyberpunk story setup and execution going on. It's not a big, you know, bombastic sci-fi action movie. Kin is cool.
Did you like District 9?
I love District 9. That was a movie that when I watched it, it took me a while to process it. There was a lot going on there. Yeah. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Did you like District 9?
I did.
Yeah, I thought the message or like the theme was very well delivered. Yeah, very, very interesting film. Did you watch Elysium?
Yeah.
I like Elysium. There was some stuff in it that I thought was kind of cheesy.
I think I enjoyed District 9 over Elysium.
Oh, me too. Definitely.
Yeah.
Chappie, I was hoping for more. I enjoyed it. I was hoping for more.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Elysium was good. There was a lot of good stuff happening in that. I can't believe that the guy, Charlton Copley, plays the villain in Elysium, for anybody who doesn't know, but I couldn't believe that was him playing the bad guy in Elysium. Like, very different casting for him. Hardcore Henry. If you guys like those types of movies, you guys have to watch Hardcore Henry. God, I love that fucking movie.
I haven't seen it yet, but I was super like doubtful of it when I first saw the trailer. I'm like, oh no.
Oh god, that movie. I mean, how do I get into this without getting into it too much? All right, so if you like action movies, right? If you are appreciator of even just the technical aspects of how things are put together, Hardcore Henry is an achievement. It is definitely one of those cinematic achievement type movies, because I don't understand how they made that movie and not have people die on set, because it's insane the stuff that happens in that film. I mean, just from the trailer alone, there's a couple of stunts where it's just like, what? How did they even do that? Blake says, I had so much fun with Hardcore Henry, it's amazing. Yeah, it is. It really is amazing. It really is amazing. The fucking the motorcycle sequence. Jesus Christ. This isn't really a spoiler because it's in the trailer, but there's a scene where the motorcycle like has a minigun on it, shoots at a van, the doors fly off, there's guys in it, and then they just drive through the van. And I thought, okay, so they probably just had like a ramp and then like the van is just CG and all the guys in it are CG. Well, yes and no. They actually drove the motorcycle through a van with stunt people on it with GoPro cameras attached to their head. And, you know, and out the front window of the van. And it's just... And this is while everything's moving, by the way. This is all on a highway and it's all happening. It's like, damn. Just damn. And there's a lot of special effects stuff that happens in it where, again, being that the film is... first person movie, how they executed that stuff is just nuts. There's one sequence in particular, it's not even an action scene, it's a playful explanation scene that goes into a character and who he is and his background and stuff. And they do some crazy transitions during that scene. Blake, you probably know what I'm talking about. Don't spoil it. where you're watching it and you're just like, how the fuck did they do this? How did they create this sequence and have it be so seamless and be shown from a first-person perspective? Yeah, I have a lot to say about Hardcore Henry, but I don't want to do spoilers until I know that everybody's seen it.
Now I have to watch it.
It's so good. It's so good. It's very, it's absurd. It's absolutely absurd. But as like a roller coaster.
Expecting.
Yeah, okay. Like as a roller coaster ride of a movie, yeah, it delivers. Pretty much from start to finish, it's just action and crazy nonsense. And it has a surprising amount of heart as well. And if you stick with it through the end, there's some stuff that you think you know what's going on about a particular scene, but when it fully plays out, you realize that it's not doing what you thought it was doing at the beginning of the film. Yeah, so if you judge movies from that perspective of like... what am I trying to say? I don't know, like Bechdel test kind of stuff. Yeah, some stuff at the beginning might be a little misleading, but it's a bit of a red herring kind of thing. With a particular memory that Henry has. Dave says, I agree, Hardcore Henry is awesome. It got a bunch of hate, but I chalk that up to jealousy. Yeah, possibly. I was watching it. I watched it again with the people that I'm working with on the whole special effects stuff. And they couldn't help but sit there going, okay, there's no way this was filmed on a GoPro camera because this film quality is too good and like the technical aspects and blah, 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 blah. But like the whole time you're sitting there going, how the fuck did they do this? trying to analyze it, and about a third of the way through the film, they're just like, alright, I give up trying to analyze it. We're just gonna have to watch special features and stuff. Because it's just too much to wrap your head around. The other amazing thing about Hardcore Henry is it was made for $2 million, which is, you know, nothing these days. It made, I want to say, 18 in US dollars, 18 million, and, I think that's a success. And, but yeah, the fact that they only made it for $2 million is also another mind-blowing part of the film, considering some of the just absolute insanity that happens in it. Blake says, when you don't know how they did it, that's how you know they did it right. Absolutely. Or even stuff you don't notice, right? Like when you don't notice that you're looking at an effect, that's definitely a successful effect, I think, too. Anyway, I'll stop going on and on about Hardcore Henry, so I'll probably just give away the whole film. I don't. But definitely one of my favorite movies in recent years. Really, really enjoy it.
Alright.
Have you watched The Raid?
No.
Those are good movies, too. If you like martial arts movies, The Raid, the first... there's two of them. The first, I think the third one's in the works, or it may have been released already, just not here. The Raid movies are phenomenal. For, again, in terms of execution as well, like how they did this stuff, The Raid is great.
So many things to watch now.
Yep. Yeah, The Raid is phenomenal. You guys in the chat seen The Raid? I know you like those IP Man movies.
Oh my god. I'm never gonna let that down.
Yeah, the raid is very much from start to finish, nonstop action, but it's like, you know, there's story sprinkled throughout it. So, like, have you watched Dredd?
Yeah.
So Dredd took a lot of inspiration from the raid. Like, the whole concept of they're there to arrest Mama, and then they get locked in, and, you know, all the bad guys start coming out, trying to hunt them down. Yeah, very much what happens in the raid. Except the raid, I would say, is much more intense than Dredd was. And that's saying a lot, because Dredd was pretty, you know, pretty intense. Pixel Plague, IP, man. Never forget. Had to be Marie.
Alright, I'm liking this a lot. I'll go with this.
Yeah, the raid is, for those, sounds like a few people haven't seen it. Dave says the Dredd script leaked before the raid came out. Yeah, but hadn't the raid been made by then? Yeah, so those of you guys who haven't seen The Raid or don't know what The Raid is, it's a Malaysian martial arts film about a guy called Rama, and him and his squad are going into a building to take down a crime boss, like a big crime boss guy. And that's where shit hits the fan, and that's the film. That's the story. But there's more to it, but I don't want to say, because that's all spoiler territory for reveals that happened during the film and whatnot.
Okay, I like this a lot. Okay, so Sal.
Alright, what do you got?
So this is open in the front.
Oh, hang on.
And there's supposed to be a railway that's supposed to go out this way.
I lost the stream window. Ah, there it is. Okay.
Right, so there's supposed to be a railway that goes out. But when things happen, the city itself kind of, like, encloses over itself.
Okay.
To lock out the...
Got it.
But for now, it's open.
And then that's what leads to the other scenes.
Mm-hmm.
Got it.
Yeah. But like how the arms are up here, they're all spindly. It's kind of hard to see because of the sketch, but they're like all tendril-esque arms. City,
we
kind of
grow
those too.
Ah, okay.
So, like, taking these, bringing them down.
Oh, this is interesting. Thanks for linking this, Dave. I disagree with some of this, though. Round 6 in the action. Oh, I'm looking at this article that Dave linked, where it kind of puts various aspects between the raid and Dredd against each other. I mean, characters, in terms of characters, Dredd wins just because it's based on something pre-existing, really. Yeah, I don't agree with this article on a lot of things, actually. The raid has some really great characters if you actually pay attention to what's going on. Dredd helps because you've got, first of all, a pre-existing IP that people are somewhat familiar with. But there's really only 3 characters in the film. I guess the imposter judges kind of count as characters, but you know, they're pretty brief. Yeah, it feels to me like whoever wrote this was very biased on Dredd. Anyway, that's besides the point. That's nuts and bolts. I don't care about that. I like both movies. So, I'll just say that. Hey, Daydreams!
Mm-hmm. Moosey asks if I work for myself.
Yeah.
I work for myself. I'm my own worst enemy.
Yep. Aren't we all? Aren't we all? The sooner we realize that, the better off we are. Pixel Plague says, I couldn't compare them, to be honest, especially the high-budget films. It's just a shame Dredd didn't get picked up for a sequel. Yeah, exactly. I can't really compare them. Cool. Dave says, I just supposed to say Dredd had the script first. Yeah, got it. Yeah, it's unfortunate that they came out roughly around the same time, theatrically anyway, because it does lay give credence to that. So thanks for linking that. That's good information. Now we know for next time.
Well,
I talk about it.
Well, get out.
Daydreams. We've been talking about movies and geeking out over Hardcore Henry and Dredd and The Raid, and it sounds like we're on a little bit of an action movie theme at the moment. And I'm still working on my crazy zombies skateboard piece. So there's that. So I'm almost done with my underpainting. Tonal painting, and then after that I'll be splashing in color and detailing the ground and adding in some halftone effects. I'm still on the fence as to whether or not I'm going to add some ink effects. I'm not sure about that yet. Let's see. Shall see.
This is so relaxing.
What is?
He's painting.
Yeah. It's been a good stream today. Definitely pumped for the rest of the week, I think. On that note, I think it's actually time for me to wrap up, because I just noticed the time.
It's time for me to...
Which is unfortunate, because Daydreams just popped in, and things are starting to pick up. Yeah, Dredd was super fun, and Carl Urban nailed it, and I love the fact that he refused to remove the helmet to keep the integrity of the character. From what I've heard, I could be wrong, but from what I've heard, it sounded like Stallone actually wanted to do the same thing, but the producers and stuff on the film thought that people wouldn't want to watch the movie if he didn't take off his mask. And I think that's a bit of a shame.
Mm-hmm.
The problem with the Stallone movie is that they tried to wedge in way too much into one film. It was just too ambitious for its own good. Kind of like the equivalent for that time of what they've tried to do with the DC Cinematic Universe. You know, they just try to wedge in way too much fan service, but too much at the same time.
Fan service.
Let's see.
It can be done so well and then done so poorly. Just. Ugh.
Yeah, Pixel Plague, what Dave was saying is that people keep saying that Dread ripped off the raid. What he was saying is that the script for Dread got released, got leaked before the raid got made. So it kind of corrects some of those assumptions that people make. There is, and I hope this is still going on, but there is rumors that Netflix will be doing a Dread series. I mean, if they do it, I'm totally down. Oh god, especially if they bring anything else in from, you know, Heavy Metal and 2000 AD, etc. Like Rogue Trooper, I would love to see a Rogue Trooper series, or ABC Warriors. Please, Netflix, if you're out there listening to me, just fucking make ABC Warriors, because that'd be great. And hire me to work on it. Oh yeah, ABC Warriors. So the ABC War Machine from the Dread movie was, again, it was cool, but they wedged in way too much into that film, and the War Machine shouldn't have been in there. Even though it was cool, it's probably like my favorite part of the whole film. I love doing this kind of realistic lighting shit. It's so sucked into that. Nemesis the Warlock? I don't remember Nemesis the Warlock. Oh, the realistic lighting, like I'm doing here, the light creeping through the clothing. Let's get really sucked into that stuff.
Is Marie still here?
She is. She's in my channel. Making the ruckus. The noise.
Good.
Hey, what's up, Harry Nipples? Steve Najera is in the house, everybody.
Just went straight for it. No hesitation.
Blake and I talked about your good news. So that's cool, Steve. And Marie says, I just want Nemesis the Warlock. Does anybody remember that guy? Go and find it, dude. Nemesis is rad. I won't stop screaming. And caps. So it sounds like I'll be looking for Nemesis the Warlock. Cool. I'll look for it. Just to make you stop screaming. Nothing else. Marie. So what are you up to, Daydreams? What's cooking for you right now? Jessica and I have been streaming for...
almost 3 hours. Oh, yeah, 3 hours.
Yeah, 3 hours. So it's going to be time to...
about to call it.
Yeah, time to call it soon here, fortunately. But it's been good. It's been a really good stream. Jessica Douglas was on... slightly.
Ah, man, I wonder if there's a way for you to record your panel.
What, the special effects stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're gonna record it.
Mm-hmm.
We're gonna record it because, we also want to do the Gumroad version of it. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna do this, the panel at Crypticon, and then we're gonna do an expanded version of it. That's gonna be more like a 3-hour lecture, and then we'll release that on Gumroad or something.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly what I want.
What I said?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. to say that, so that's why I did it.
You fell for my peer pressure.
Your psychic pressures. Yes. That's better. Seems you just have to make that right brush to get it to do what you want it to do. Steve says, yeah, super excited for New York Comic Con, just a bummer it needed to be done because the show was so bad.
Oof.
Yeah. But at least they, you know, at least they did something right for you, and it sounds like the way you handled it was very professional and actually very considerate for them. Sounds to me like you were doing them a favor by letting them know your observations and thoughts on why this show was a failure. And, you know, they want to hear that shit. Because they're business people, and if they want to make money, they got to figure out how to improve. So that's cool, man. Congratulations, Steve. Stebbin. I don't want to call him his real name online, because too many people might take to it. Start using it frequently. I mean, can you imagine what would happen if I let everybody know that his real name was Stephane?
Stephane?
I mean, people might just laugh and start calling him that all the time.
Like me?
Say, he says, they knew it was a shit show on Friday. So Plague says, you think they're just getting too big? Are they?
That's what happens with a lot
Stefano.
Of conventions, is that they don't scale.
Yeah. Steve says when his rep came up to him, he leaned forward with his face and was just like, just hit me. They must have been getting shit all weekend. Well, from what you were saying, it sounds like, you know, there's a lot of angry vendors and stuff at the show. So, yeah, makes sense. I mean, at that point, it's kind of hard not to take notice. Steve says, so Pixel Plague asked, do you think it just got too big? And Steve says, no, I think they just thought they were hot shit and didn't have to do any work to put on a decent show. So yeah, exactly what I was saying about maybe a little bit too much hubris there, driving the way things got handled, which is unfortunate because the people who are attending and the people who are vending are the ones who pay for that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Be interesting to see if they do this show again and how they'll handle it in future. having had the lesson that they just had.
You know, while I was at Saki Anime, somebody flew in from Texas and tried to claim a table or tried to claim a badge. And they didn't realize that they couldn't proxy sell for another artist.
Oh.
So, yep.
So they flew in for nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. That's how you find shit out in advance. Communication. Expectations and whatnot. Alright, you guys. You guys have been great. I think it's time to wrap this up.
Yep, me too.
Sucks because more people are showing up and it's party just never stops. I may or may not be streaming tomorrow. It depends on what's going on. But for sure, Wednesday night, we will be here. Tonight, there's a stream going on. Jessica, go for it.
Yeah, so my co-founder, Mark, for Lonely Egg Studio, he's going to be continuing his Let's Play of Broken Age.
Nice.
So you can watch that at Lonely Egg Studio on Twitch. We'll be there playing Broken Age.
Pixel Plague says, I regret coming. Thanks for the bad experience.
Thanks, Marie.
Thanks, Marie.
Well,
if you guys
want
to harass Marie while she's on the stream, the Lonely Egg Studio team will also be streaming on Thursday night, doing some art and working on game stuff. And it's usually Catherine, Jessica, myself, and Pixel Plague. So come and harass Pixel Plague, if nothing else. otherwise, we will be streaming on Wednesday night, 8 p.m. CST, for the big hangout party stream here at the clubhouse. And you guys know how crazy those streams can get. So, yeah, be here on Wednesday, be here on Thursday, and if you can, be here tonight. Not on this channel, but on the Lonely Egg Studio channel for that game stream tonight. So, Marie says, but I'm so nice, though.
Wow. Wow. Just lying through your teeth. I just...
Yeah. Just... That kind of... This, that kind of illusion... Illusional... yeah. It's tragic.
It's tragic.
Alright, you guys. Dave says, thanks for the stream. No, thank you guys. Thank you guys for being here. Thanks for hanging out with us. Thanks for your great questions and conversations. Always a pleasure. And... here comes everyone's favorite jolly red mutant guy.
Wow.
Play him off, jolly red mutant guy. Look at him, he looks so happy. Marie's giving us side eye.
Alright, see you guys in a bit.
Take care, guys.